Good evening, folks. We're going to open the meeting at 7:05 with 2/3 of the board present, Town Administrator and Recording Secretary. Mr. Grohl is having a hard time getting out of traffic out of Hudson where he works now. They moved his location, so he shall be here, so we're told. So in the meantime, we get going, though. As long as Paul and I don't disagree, we're good. So, that being the case, I'm going to go out of order, and because I know you're looking to get out of here, so come on up, Linda, and then we'll take care of your stuff and go from there. The floor is yours while I'm looking for the paperwork.
Did you get a chance to look at the memo?
Yes, I did.
It's clipped to a folder.
Yeah, last thing on the pile.
In the past, it's been my practice when I hire a deputy to start them at a lower wage than the deputy before them, because it didn't seem fair to have a deputy come in brand spanking new and pay them at the same rate as the previous one who had some training, a certain amount of training under their belt. So when we hired Gary, I went with that same premise, not realizing, or I don't even know if it was in effect at the time, that there had been a wage scale implemented. So tonight, before the end of the year, I wanted to make sure that Gary got his pay increase, and Lean and I discussed it, and as you see in the memo, there's sufficient funding in the budget. I was going to ask that it be made retroactive to August, which would have been 3 months after he was hired, but where this wage scale has already been in place, can we just make it retroactive if there's sufficient funding to start him at that rate?
Well,
go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, and that's why I needed to hear an explanation, because I wasn't sure. To be real honest, that's why they set a wage scale. And so I think it denies the person, whoever it is, whatever department it is, to start them at a lower rate below that wage scale.
Absolutely.
And then try to bring them up. So, in my opinion, it probably makes sense to pay the wage scale we should have from day one going forward, because we knew we were assuming that.
Right, and I didn't. I had not been aware of the wage scale, and I think that had come up at one previous meeting. I was never aware that one had been implemented. So, if you folks are all for it, I think it would be.
I think you were aware of the chart, but you still had your method of hiring them.
I was aware of the chart, but it was like the initial one that covered when it was first done. I just don't remember it being extending to deputy.
Right, Brian did a nice job to identify the part-timers, the elected officials, and the full-timers.
Right.
So those,
the initial one had been done before you were on board.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And so when you had done the other one, for whatever reason, I was unaware that had taken place.
Yeah, we did that when Ron was on the board. I think that was one of the last things you did before you resigned, because we finalized that wage scale.
So that one was okay. So yes, I thank you for pointing that out. So that should have been the case, and it was just kind of ignorance on my part, or a blip in the communication.
No.
But that will be a nice little surprise for Gary, and it will be a surprise for Gary, I'm sure. He's going to watch the movie, you know it. So thank you very much for doing that.
It would be one thing if you were paying it, there'd be a difference. You had someone for a period of time, and someone's coming in and earning a higher rate, but they set this as a person coming in and working their way up. So
which was a great thing to do, which is why before this was ever in place, I kind of created my own, because I said it wasn't fair to start somebody at the same rate that the person with experience just left with.
No, that's the idea of the wage scale, so yeah.
Right.
I would standardize
scale
to take and work with them, as things progress.
Oh, I fully understand the reasoning behind it, but it just never existed until recently.
Unfortunately, do we have funds available to?
Yep, it's all in the spreadsheet. There's still.
Right, but I mean, if we go all the way back to day one.
Yep, I just adjusted the spreadsheet.
We do, because he didn't start. He started a month after I had planned for him to start, I think.
Yeah,
I was going to start.
So his total
April,
hours
he
is
didn't
this.
Start till May.
Those are hours.
Okay, and if you take that. should be hours times 50 cents. That was the original. I must have thrown away the wrong packet. That times 50 cents. I just updated the entire spreadsheet, so.
And he'll be working for me next week on vacation, but it's 3 days.
Looking at 327.85.
Extra, or the total?
Total, to adjust the 50 cents. That's what we'd be paying. He's not working this week, so then if we change the rate, do a.
Right, because next week is on the following.
Following year even.
Following year.
Yep.
We got the money, I make a motion that we take and pay him the.
Oh, she told me about it.
Standard wage scale rate from day one, make that adjustment.
Yep, and then, so there'll still be like $1,000, well, no, $300 left.
Yeah, for a rental of $327.85.
I'll second that.
Discussion. We already had it.
Yeah.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye, so.
Well, thank you, and now we're all on the same page, so thank you for that.
I'll make sure Allison gets that information so that she can pay it next Tuesday, so it's done in this calendar year.
Corin, you certainly can share that with him.
I never tell anyone.
Really?
No, it's all right, this is public.
You know better than to ask, too.
He does know better than to ask.
That's good.
That one, so thank you.
So, you know, for, yeah, I guess in the future, we just, you know, we have a wage scale out.
Well, now we know, now I know. But Gary's not leaving, he's staying here forever, so it's moot point.
Are you sure?
Wish I had that confidence.
That's what I said to Corin.
It's his birthday?
It's his birthday, so he's 70.
Seven?
Yeah.
Happy birthday to Gary.
Have a good.
Shall we all sing to the camera?
No.
Have a good holiday.
Thanks, you as well.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you, Linda.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Alrighty, now, we'll go back into our regular thing, we'll do the minutes. Since we're down for us, I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes as written.
And I'll second that.
Alright, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any discussion?
No, I actually.
You second that as written, so.
Make a correction, so.
Ready to that, so. Aye. I'll sign that, we'll bump to public comment.
I'm all set, thank you.
Mike, all set, Woody, public comment?
Oh, good, thanks.
John?
Good.
Better close public comment then. Woody, you're next then.
What's up?
Go on up. Solid waste.
Yes. Make sure I get my little one out here. Okay. On this budget here, there's three areas with some pretty big increases in them. I'm not gonna all explain them to you.
I hope.
Huh?
I hope.
Oh yeah. The first one you're gonna come across is the part-time employees. On the part-time employees, what I budgeted for this year versus what happened last year. Last year, the additional person wasn't budgeted for the whole year. This year, that additional person is budgeted for the whole year. That's part of it. And I changed, originally the intent was to do 32 hours across the board. However, this additional employee, financially, is a big difference going 32 for everybody across the board. So I went, the new person that we bring in will be at 28 hours a week. That's what I'm budgeting for.
So it'll be three at 32 and one at
28. It'll be two at 32, one at 12, because he works the Saturday and the Wednesday night. And then
one at
28. One at 28. And that'll give me, what that'll give me will be, including myself, it'll give us five on Saturday, five on Tuesday, and then five on Wednesday, and Thursday will be a, I can either take this person, if I don't need them Wednesday night, we can flex it Wednesday night, or Thursday would be the flex point there. So either we're at 4 hours that day, or you know, however it works out. But that's,
we
brought it within reason.
But we don't have that person yet, because we have one leaving.
We have one leaving. Right.
So we have to find that other person.
Right, I'm assuming the, actually not assuming, I'm planning on doing something soon. I'll get together with Lean and we'll get look at the old applications that we have and see what we can come up with. And then, so that explains that one. You go down the line, I took out my overtime. The reason I did that, my thought is I'm gonna have these people. Okay, and there's really, I can't see the need for me to actually be in on an overtime. The only times past, if I don't have the staff, and that's a difference. But if I have to flex some of my time to stay within my 40 hours, if there's a major breakdown, I have to come in, you know, be there longer for trucking or whatever, I should be able to work within my hours and still have my staff coverage. That's my plan. That was the reason for taking that out of there.
I could tell you my opinion, we'll put something in there.
Okay.
Only to keep the line item open.
Okay.
Because I know it's a little bit of a gray area, but I know from the trainings I've had in the past, if you're taking zero out a line item like that, even though the budget passed and we have the right to move money, but there's no money in that line item,
okay,
we can't automatically just add money to a line item.
Okay.
It's gonna have something in there already, you know. So, you know, even if it's $10, at least it keeps it alive.
To shift money?
Yeah.
It has to be money in order for you to move the money,
yes,
to another line?
I believe so.
Okay.
And
that's what I recall.
So what do you want to put there?
Put $1, you put $5, you put $10, I mean, whatever, I mean, anything, all it needs is $1 to keep it open,
all right,
keep it alive.
Want to do $1 like we did in another line earlier?
Sure. Because, I mean, because once you do that, you basically seal that line item, is what the Municipal Association training tells you.
Okay.
And the next line down stayed the same, the equipment rental line. That's basically our, the mower that we rent twice a year. The training, this year, coming up year, there'll be training for all the employees, and I'm also, I put $75 in there for the conference that the NRA puts on.
Yep.
My plan is to take and have the head custodian from the school. They have one day that's pretty much dedicated to the school, you know, for the school, children, that kind of thing. I figured that'd be a good day to get him involved, because he's pretty much the one that's heading up things at the school. And I spoke with the principal, and he's okay with it. And so I budgeted for him in there as well. Subcontractor services. I know this is just a rough part. We might actually take that one out of there. If I can get, I'm trying to get some stuff done now. If I can get it done now, then I'm just going to take that line out. I basically only have one little project to get done, and once that's done, I don't see it needed in there. Supplies, I dropped that line down 500. Maintenance, I kept it the same. Department equipment, equipment, that line. My intentions for this year are to purchase a signboard. Not an electronic signboard, but a portable signboard that has, I've seen them at Sam's Club, did like 300, 400 bucks, something like that, for us to give notifications. And we could do when we're closed, that kind of stuff,
right,
you know, if we're closing special and that kind of thing. And then if there was something to happen in town, I don't have an issue. And like Old Home Day, you could you could throw that on the sign.
Chicken
but
barbecue.
Whatever you want to put on there. I don't care what you put on there. And just, you know, right now we have a piece of plywood, you know, it's kind of,
right,
you know, this would be a little more professional. And the other thing is a portable air compressor. Right now, I have to go someplace to get air. I'm the only one that can do it because I'm the only one that can drive the truck. So to blow my tires up, I have to go over. Luckily, Billy's been very good at letting us use his air compressor, because his air compressor goes high enough to blow up my tires. My tires run at 100 and, no, I'm not more than that, like 150 on that, because I have floats at the big tires on it. Like 150, so in order to maintain air pressure in them, and we do the tire pressure basically in that truck, I do it every 2 weeks, same as I grease the hoist every 2 weeks, and the reason I do that, we've actually found issues, or I found where you actually have a flat and you didn't know it, or you have a tire that's going soft, you have something in it, you don't happen to see it, this is a way I can find it without destroying the tire, and that's worked really well. So that's the other major chunk of it. They're $500 from what I've seen, and I have to do a portable because it needs to be inside my building where it's warm.
Which line is that? Equipment?
That's in the equipment line.
Okay.
That's what I put in there. The next line down is the telephone. I left that the same. I think we'll be fine with that. The uniform line is up. And you say, how come that's up? Well, I figured in there, we have a cost increase that comes in August. So from August to December, there's a 5% increase. And said that, we also, in that line, the boots that we pay for the employees. Next year, you're gonna have four sets of boots, which is like $600. So there's another chunk of it. And figuring uniforms for the new employee 6 months out. Because it's after 6 months, they would get their boots, and after 6 months, they would get their uniform. So that's all figured in there. This year, obviously, that employee didn't get shoes, and didn't get uniforms. There's one here where they needed hired till that point. The mobile phone.
Well, boots are required to wear steel toe, right?
Yes, it's an OSHA-approved safety shoe. Right. We have the numbers, and basically what I do, the guys can go where they want.
Right.
However, the easiest thing I found is I have the truck come right to us.
Yeah.
He'll bring you, basically tell him what we're looking for. He has us right in the computer.
Very familiar with shoe truck.
No, no, but I mean, it works really well. Have him come right to the shop and do it right there. The phone, I went off from what we've been paying on it, on the cell phone, and that's what that figures out at 12 months. Fuel cost, last year was budgeted 55. I figured out what I used and what I'm anticipating for the end of this year. And then considering fuel's probably gonna go up a little bit, kind of split the difference between the two.
Yep.
So I dropped it down to 4,800. The ash lab and testing, basically I left that the same. Fees and services, that I zeroed it, but like you guys said, we need to leave a one in there, so. Incineration in the new budget, Lena and I talked about this once, changing that to MSW, because it's not incinerated anymore, that's basically MSW. That one there, we have a contract. A contracted price for 2016 is currently $61.25. It will go to $63 a ton. This current year, excuse me, we budgeted for 864 tons, I believe. And I'm gonna come in, I just did some rough figuring because we still gotta go till the end of next week. I'm probably gonna come in around somewhere around 860 tons. So having said that, in the anticipation of some additional residents coming in, and the moving around of, when people move in and out of town, it actually creates a lot more trash for us.
Oh yeah.
This year I'm budgeting at 875. There's too many unknowns. So that's gonna give it an increase of $1.75 a ton. At 875 tons, that's what brings it up to the 55,125.
Sounds reasonable.
On the next line, the construction and demolition debris. Let's see, our current price is $64.50 a ton. It's gonna go to $67.37 a ton, which is a $2.87 a ton increase. Last year we budgeted for, I know I wrote it down here someplace. I'll find that. Currently, we're at 139.41 tons. I budgeted last year, I believe it was for 130 tons, what I budgeted last year. So already over from last year's number. This year, and we didn't deliver our ash. Our burn pit didn't get cleaned out this year. So we'll have to clean that next year. This year I'm budgeting for 150 tons, which I think seeing what we did this year, and then adding in for the ash, I think we're gonna be in that 150 ton bracket. So that's the increase on that line. The next line, Lena and I talked about this. Unfortunately, I haven't gotten back up here for us to actually make the official change, but the hazardous waste collection and the recycling cost line, I've asked if that could be combined as one line. It gets pretty confusing when you're doing when I'm signing my bills for it, because most of it is the same thing. I mean, you can look at one thing and say, oh, that technically hazardous waste, or it's not. In that line is your free.
Hazardous waste collection was for the.
It's for that plus your freons go in there, because that's technically hazardous waste. See, that's where I'm saying where it gets confusing. I felt it would be much easier to put it in as a one line. You know, you have your recycling stuff in there, your propane tanks, your tires, everything is gonna come out of that one line.
But we're not gonna use the hazardous waste collection description we're gonna use.
Yeah, we were gonna do like a half, how we...
Slash?
Yeah.
Recycling?
Remember, I hadn't gotten back up here to talk with you about it. But that we just briefly touched on it, about making that a...
What I pointed out to Woody is those four-digit code.
Right.
4324, 4325, I looked up the DRA description. And one of these, and I can't recall, I don't have the paper in front of me.
I don't either.
One is specific, and it really says, for closing a hazard, for a hazardous spill type thing. And the other one was to close...
Yeah, I think it was.
A transfer station, and something to that, so...
Like a landfill or something?
Yeah, that's what it was, so,
I think one of that.
No, and I don't...
And I think it was, on the paper that Lean sent me, and I didn't think to grab it, that...
Excuse me.
That 4324 line, I think is pretty more open, it actually covers more stuff than the 4325. That one there, I think is the one that's like she said, was the, if you had a hazardous waste spill.
Right.
Or if, it was a closure of something, might have been landfill, like you said. So the other stuff, it kind of falls more under that other line item anyways. I decreased that, the combination of those two lines, I decreased it.
I guess as long as we can track it appropriately, so, you know, if anybody asks questions, that they, you know, they want the information, be able to check, give them the information, I don't know. Personally, I don't care which way you do it, I'm not, you will.
I just put a note here of combining it, but I know you're gonna probably highlight what went where.
When we get, I believe Allison does that pretty well on the, when she does the budget here. It'll actually, you know, I'll put the account number, and she puts a description in here. Like, when she does an MSW, it says MSW here, it'll say glass, it'll say freon, whatever the product is. So you'd be able to track it right through here pretty easy, I believe. And then, the last one on that line is our NRA dues, and that's the 194. And I asked if it was changing, and they said, no, it's not changing for this year.
So we're adding $2?
$2.
$1 for business services and one for overtime?
Yeah, sure.
Excuse me.
Increase is $8,440.
$8,040?
$440.
$440. Any questions for him, or any...
Not me.
Say anything about, really, it jumps out at me, you know, for question wise and whatnot. Yeah, and then, like I said, this is all preliminary, so we're gonna, you know, put it all together, and, you know, I'm sure we'll have some questions down the road possibly, but...
Yeah, and like I said, if I, if I can get this little project done, which I'm trying to, not that's a lot, but it'll take a little of the $750 out of it.
Any warrant articles, anything like that?
I'm not planning on, what I'm actually planning on is, I know the pickup truck's been a big controversy. Basically, my plan is...
Got a sticker on it, right?
You printed one. It has a sticker, we'll just say it has a sticker on it. We'll just say it has a sticker on it. The plan is to run another year.
Yeah.
And, you know, if we have a major catastrophe, then we'll have to figure something out then, but, you know, basically, for it to pass another inspection, it has to have, and not an inspection that it had, it needs to actually have a good inspection on it. In the bottom line, it's a liability to us, if somebody gets hurt in that truck.
Absolutely.
You know, that's that's a liability. But for now.
Are you asking for CIP money?
Nope.
Put anything in the fund?
Nope, not doing. Nope. I'm not asking for nothing. I think, it is too many variables at this point right now. I think at some point I'd like to sit down with the board and discuss some ideas that I have for the future, things that we're gonna have to change. So I think before we just stop putting money in, I mean, we have some money in there now. And that's fine to start. And I think, you know, at some point I wanna sit down and I got some ideas of things we need to change, things we need to do. And obviously it's gonna cost money, so.
Nothing's for free.
No, no, you know, I understand that. You know, we'll figure out how we wanna attack it, but to, you know, to take money right now and just put it in there to sit, where we have money sitting there. We got some things we need to figure out and go forward from there. And plus, I mean, I have a pretty good increase in my budget, so I ask for more. Not at this time.
Okay. But we're here for, I mean, all the cards on the table so we can figure it all out.
Yep, that's what, I mean, that's, like I said, I got some things that we'd like to do and go from there. But for now, no.
I would ask if you had any questions for him, but I think that'd be kind of a.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Alrighty, well. Thanks. Steve, we'll update, we on order and talk to Linda about the shed.
Gary.
Yep. And, so we'll go over that and that's squared away for the minutes and help all comment and just finish up Woody.
Okay.
Budget. And John, you're next.
I typed your numbers in so they are correct, accurate.
Clear?
Yeah.
That's solid waste.
They're not doing me.
Oh, I gave you the wrong.
Well, you might want this budget,
yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll go down through it. First line is our stipend pay. Started out about over 10 years ago at $10,000 and we've inched it up a little bit. Mm-hmm. Obviously it's only gone up $3,000 in 10 years. Usually when you give a pay increase to employees, we figure that in, but this year I didn't do that. It would have been like $800 increase, so I just rounded it to 13. Try to keep it there maybe for a year. Just to round that figure out. So that's a $200 increase. This
so,
year.
Okay, so that number is not including the CIP increase?
What was the points? What did the average out?
$665. $6.65 per call. Now that's not per hour. I'll give you an example of what I guys do. Thursday night. We got a medical 11:15 over east, transported the lady to CMC. Truck was kind of, was a lot of blood involved, get cleaned up. They got home at 2. 5 o'clock, we went to mutual aid to Gosstown for the structure fire.
Yeah,
back at 10, got the truck cleaned up. 11:30, had a cardiac arrest on Long Pond Road.
Yeah, about that.
Yeah, and so there's probably 14 hours. Guys work 12 out of 14 hours and they get $19.95. So, you know, they're not doing it for the money, obviously. So so that just works out per point. You get a point for going to a call. I get points for training. If you take like a refresher course, I get more points. I give the deputies points for doing permits because that's a hassle. If someone takes a full course, someone takes a refresher course, you just divvy up. What we do is at the end of the year, take all the points that are accumulated and divide them into this 13,000. That gives me a dollar figure. That's how the payroll gets paid.
So you don't have an actual basic amount dollar figure then?
Well, it depends on how many calls you go, how many people go up the calls, how much training you get done. So that's how that works.
Is there a dollar value per point? Is
yep,
the
$6.
This year it's average.
So it's six and some change for a point, and you earn your points for whether you're stipend once a year?
Yep.
Yeah.
And it comes out of the 13.
Yep.
Yeah.
Wow, that's a
But next year it could be $5 a change for a point.
Yeah, we have a lot of calls. This year it's actually up, because we had less people made some calls, and I don't pay, I have a minimum of 10 points, you gotta earn 10 points, you don't get paid. So, we had less people drawing on the money this year, so it actually was up. It's usually around $5, it's $4.50 to $5 this year.
What's a point equal to? Is that an hour, or is it?
One call, per call.
That's per call. So now, how long a call takes?
Yep, 1 hour or 12 hours, yeah.
Average ambulance call takes us, we go to Concord, that's, if you push, you get an hour and a half out. We go to Elliott, that's 2.5 hours. We go to CMC, you get 2 hours, and someone has to come back and do the report. You know, the hospital requires to do a medical report in 24 hours. But that's hard to do. Anybody's got a job, you come home.
Right.
Sit down at a computer, you gotta fill out the report, so, you know, we don't really, we try to stick to that, but we don't. So next line's my pay for administration, it's not that full amount. We put a little extra in there for me doing some inspections that aren't done through the, building department, wood stove inspections. I do safety inspections, I do foster care inspections, I do place of assembly inspections, I do child care facilities, people that have do child care at their home. So that fee is separate from the building department, so there's extra in there to cover those fees. Oil burners used to be in there, but tens of the oil burners I'm doing now kind of through the building department, so it's just a way because we commit to that. An oil burner permit. That was a fee for an oil burner permit.
So there's new installations.
So there's revenue. Yeah. So this revenue comes in against this particular line item, then, in theory.
No, I don't charge.
Not always. No, you don't.
For these, no.
No, the sections I do, there's no charge.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
In the state, you know, on foster care and child care at the home, daycare centers have to be inspected. That's a state requirement.
Okay.
Forest fire, that's just a figure we throw in there. It's this year we want to work because we have more forest fires. You know, we do get that rate when you do go to a forest fire. Some of that's, we can refund 50% of that from the state. So that figure is just a wild card. I mean, if we ever had a forest fire in Dunbarton, you know, we could easily succeed that by a lot of money. We've just been pretty fortunate. And you know, you're required to pay that. The state will help you out on some, but we've just been really fortunate. That used to be a line item in the Selectman budget. And years ago, they put it in the fire department budget because ultimately you'd have to pay the bill.
Yeah.
You know, if we had a major brush fire, forest fire, the state's got to pay. I mean, town's got to pay the help funds. So
absolutely.
We've just been lucky. Training and keep that the same. I actually got a couple bills I got to turn in for the end of the year. These courses are getting wicked expensive. What I do is reimburse people that they want to take an EMS course. I got a young guy right now, and I'm taking an advanced course so I can do IVs, and it's a higher level. That's gone up to $1,450 per course. An EMT course when I started, fire chief, was $400. Then it jumped to $600, went to $800. Went to $950, went to $1,000. I just got some flyer in the mail the other day for a course coming through. $1,250 now for a EMT class. Plus you got to test out, the testing fee involved, so it's getting crazy. And what I do, I first used to pay for that front, but I got burned a couple of times. People didn't finish the course, so now if somebody wants to take an EMT course, they take it, they pass it, you get all your certificates and your path, then we reimburse for the class. So, and some people, you know, unfortunately, some people financially can't afford even to take the basic course. I try to work with them, but you know, depends. I can usually feel if the guy's gonna fall through with it. So I have helped a couple people out.
Don't you also have a policy where if they leave within so many
days,
they
reimburse us.
They reimburse us, which
we had one, actually one person did that.
Yeah.
Paid it back.
Right.
Because that was the thing. People, we were, you know, we were training, paying for the training. As soon as they got trained, they left.
Right.
You know, so you know, it's hard for us as a volunteer base to tell somebody they got to stay and you know, for 2 years and pay that back. You know, people move on, they sell their house, so but at least, you know,
they can reimburse us, we can try to recoup that money. And we have, that one person did.
Well, I mean.
Got burnt before that, but.
It sounds very similar to our, the training fund that we have in the town budget. I mean, would you want us to take and just make one training budget like that and to, for your particular needs? And it's the same basic thing we do right now is someone, you know, we're reimbursing for their, you know, they have to bring their grades in and such, prove they finished the course, and then we reimburse them. But also, you know, I think we also have a form that they fill out too, correct?
Well, how's that different than what the police department does?
They have to put in the request that they wanna take X amount, a certain class that gets approved by the selectman.
Right.
And then we budget that on the, based on that request.
But you probably need to compensate the goal too, right? If you're paying on, they're full-time employees, they're probably getting hourly rate.
No, this is for their own.
Oh, for their own?
Yeah, I mean, they're like, for example, Chris Rollard, you know, is going for.
Master's.
Master's degree.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he's going on his own time doing it, and then we reimburse him, but, you know, he lets us know what classes they take.
Yeah.
But, I mean.
Yeah. Okay, mutual aid, you know, that's a fee we don't have any control over, and we are very fortunate this year.
I guess so.
Only had an increase of $437, the first time in many years, it hasn't been over $1,002. Some factors out, we've worked on the formula a little bit, on what the towns pay.
Well.
We're trying to make it more equalized, fair for everybody in the compact, and we did, you know, we had picked up Hooksett in Hillsborough in the last couple of years, and they were finally in for a full year. So that helped keep the cost down. Our coordinators, you know, his, he kept his budget down. Thing that really, we don't have a lot of control over is the dispatches. They're union, they have a contract, they're city employees, and, you know, we can't really negotiate with them. It's a kind of a, it's a little bit of a.
Understand.
But anyways, that's, we don't have those costs, and that, that's always the increase in the budget, but.
So you overspent it this year, huh?
Yeah, I must have figured around 2 cents or something.
$5?
$5, yeah.
That's not bad.
Hopefully, I did the right figure. Gas and diesel, you know, it's, I had to figure those, price of gas going up, and I could have tweaked it a little, just like, because we did, we do have another gas vehicle now, that pickup truck. Well, last year we had the diesel pickup, so it's probably gonna be a little closer than it was. But, you know, those figures are just something you gotta, we've never really gone over them, so. Telephone, what it is, the mobile phone, I'm increasing that, because I'll explain a little bit later, but I'm gonna have to get a different phone, do what I wanna do, so. And we have two, that basically is all for the, majority that's for the ambulance. They have a cell phone in the ambulance, and then we have Wi-Fi device, so we can transmit our EKGs to the hospital. Our monitor, if we had a newer monitor, has Wi-Fi capability, but we don't have it in ours, so we have to have a separate device, so there's a monthly charge, even though we get the, you know, the government rate through the Verizon, it's still, still a cost, so. It's really, you know, you need to have that. Equipment maintenance will keep the same, trucks are getting older. You know, our newest truck's already, it's an 05, so that's already, you know, 12 years old. I just spent $1,400 on the pump on that this month. A lot of it was, electronic issue, but, you know, it gets costly, so. Might have to do some tires next month, next year, so. Anyway, inspections, that all comes out of there. Dues, those are dues that belong to NFPA, New Hampshire Fire, New Hampshire Fire Chiefs Association, and one of the international ones, which pays you off in the long run, because you can get a lot of legislature information out of those. I dropped that $50, didn't seem to use that much. Radio repair, that's another thing, you just, you know, don't know, gonna break a radio. Radio repair is pretty expensive, but I'll say today world, when you get sent back or factory, or they give you a new power. Pages, I did purchase two pages just recently, and I gone to a different vendor, I'm trying a different pager. They're a little bit cheaper, they're a little bit lighter, I actually have one on. So my Motorola is kind of a monopoly in the radio world. Well, this one's made by Swiss Phone, it's half the weight as a Motorola, it only takes a charge of AA battery. Motorola batteries are over $20 a piece now, so there are some features to it. The clip's a little chizzy, if not it might break, but I don't know, it's fighter proof, we'll find out. So I purchased a couple of them. You see the slip there. So, like I said, they're Western Motorola. So I like to keep that there because I like to at least pick up a couple pages a year. I do have, you know, it seems that lately when they break, they go to the factory and they can't be repaired.
Mm-hmm.
Either they tell you, you have to put a whole new circuit board in, or and even the case, they can't. Okay, everything goes to Mexico, which is a depot. No one sits down at the desk table anymore and fixes stuff. It's
that's
all sent out. That's the world we're in. Protective gear, same cost. You know, I try to buy a couple sets of gear a year.
Mm-hmm.
Firefighting gear, and that's hose. And I really haven't bought any hose. I did buy, just bought four lengths of a tack hose and bought some suction hose that I haven't received yet. Some of our suction hose on the two tankers are as stiff as a piece of steel pipe. You can't bend them, so I ended up buying some flex hose for that this year. But I should really, I gotta start buying some more hose, regular supply hose, just, you know, find
gotcha.
You. Anyways, that comes out of there. Subscriptions, the magazines and journals, fire prevention, that $1,000 is basically just for the school. You know, it pays dividends, we go to the school, we see every kid in the school, do education with them, and you'd be surprised the stories they tell you about something's happened in the house, the mother started something on fire, cooking, they told them how to put it out, you know, the father did this, you know, they tell you all these wild stories. So it's worth the money.
Absolutely.
Dry hydrant repair. We do maintenance on mowing, brush cutting. Jeff's helped me out on some. He did a lot of work on the one up on Clifford Farms. He did the road up to it and cut the road back and put some gravel in there. But there's some fence repair that really needs to be done. You know, those fire ponds, they're our responsibility to maintain them.
Mm-hmm.
The fences get knocked down, trees fall over. Jeff's going to try to get that one out of Jacqueline Drive this year. And the ice is, if we get enough ice, you can get on the ice to cut it, but it's done some damage there. So I really should try to do some kind of fence repair to them, but that's just maintenance. They only get them all around them, cut the brush grows. This year I cut all the brush inside the fence on the one on the grapevine. Just grows quick, you know. That one down on Jewett Road, that thing's got overtaken by trees. At one time, Les tried to set up a program with the state prison to have them come
right.
do it, but never got off the ground.
Yeah.
Ambulance supplies, that's for ambulance equipment. I did drop that down $500. Some of that stuff we can get through the hospital, but for some supplies, and we have to purchase ourselves. You know, bandages and oxygen, we have to pay for the oxygen. Batteries, actually, at this cardiac arrest the other day, they had a battery issue with one of the defibs, so they ended up checking the rest, and I got to buy defib batteries, and
mm-hmm.
some pads are out of date.
Those get checked on a monthly basis, sir.
We keep in charge. It wasn't that we didn't have a dead battery, it's just that we keep both batteries rotating through, but some of them, actually the others are all out of date and need to be replaced. So. So I got that bill coming, trying to get that this year, because he had to buy some pads and some other medical stuff just recently. So anyways, that's the bottom line. Well, I skipped the fees and services. That's going to be, you see, that's quite an increase. Well, what the deal is there is that I usually use that line item. Some of my money get taken out of different accounts. Lean, try to straighten some of it out today.
I fixed it all.
Did you?
What's on this is accurate.
When we did the renovations at the fire station,
yeah.
We had to pay for our own internet now.
Right.
That the police, we're on the police's, so we split that. So I've been taking that fee out of that line item, but it got taken out of one of the phone items. But anyways, we have a program to do our fire reporting on.
Mm-hmm.
And we're mandated by the state, we have to give them that information monthly. So there's a couple of programs out there. One's called Firehouse, what we currently have, we've had for many, many years. And what happened was, it's a program on our computer,
mm-hmm.
and our computer got a virus
yeah.
over there last year, wiped out everything in the computer
mm-hmm.
except our Firehouse program. So now the Firehouse program's in this computer,
mm-hmm.
but we can't do anything. We can do the reports, but we can't transport them, export them
mm-hmm.
to the state. So we can't, I'll back up a little bit. Firehouse has a, it's supposed to have been a monthly fee.
Mm-hmm.
You pay a yearly fee for support services. It's mandated by the paper. Well, when I was working in Concord, there was a guy doing Firehouse in Concord, he told me not to pay it. He said, I'll do all your updates for you and all that stuff. So that worked fine, he was doing it. Then obviously I retired. So I just stopped paying it because I didn't think I was getting my money's worth what we were getting out of it. So I never paid it for, oh, back to 2010. So now, the computer's crashed, we gotta upgrade the program. Well, they say we have to back pay them $4,700 that we didn't pay if we wanna stay with the Firehouse program. So this other program out there is ImageTrend. And ImageTrend gives you more benefits. You can actually do your reports from remote device. You could actually be in the ambulance and start your report before you came home. You can do it remotely. I can do it at my house. Where Firehouse is basically one computer-based program. It's in that.
This one's web-based.
Yeah. So, ImageTrend, which is the other, there's two basically programs up to report your fire stuff. Firehouse and ImageTrend. Now, ImageTrend, if we went with ImageTrend, initially, it'd be $6,000, and then it will be an annual fee of $600 annual fee. So, Gosstown uses ImageTrend. So, Gosstown will allow us to go on to their system. And that cost is $2,100.
Like a user.
Yeah, because you know, one of my guys is their IT tech down there. And he does all their stuff. So he approached them. They had no problem. The chief down there, they can go on, use them as the main, you know, the main agent. We can be associated with them, and that fee is $1,500 to initially do that, to get up and running. They're going to charge us $1,500, then a $600 annual rate. So the Firehouse program, if we pay them that $4,750 they want, which I'm not really leaning towards because there's more benefits to go to the ImageTrend,
right.
And they're $675. They were $750 when I started dealing with them, but the rate they quoted me, maybe they gave us a deal. It was $665 for the back years. But I used to pay them $750 when I was paying them. But anyways, they'd be $665 annually. So in this line item, I've added that $2,100 to get the signature and up and going. And then there's another program out there, which that $800 would be for. It's called I Am Responding. And that's another system that the Compact has adopted. There's systems out there, different programs, different companies, and the Compact wanted to go with one company. So, because they put this information out when there's a call, basically they dispatch, they put it out over your phone.
Yep.
We currently get it now over our phones. We get on pager, and they put it out on the phone. So this program's called I Am Responding, and a lot of departments already have it.
Mm-hmm.
They're giving us a discount for the compact, if the whole compact agrees to go to it. And it's, so if there's a call, they just, they put it out on the cell phone, you can look at your phone, and when someone's on responding, they sign off. So, I could look at my phone and know that Woody's coming, Jasmine, whatever, so I know that there's at least two or three people coming to get the ambulance out. Or if it's a fire call, who's coming, who signs on, so there's benefits. That's one of the biggest benefits the towns are seeing, that they know who's already coming, signed on the road, so, and you don't have to call, you know, maybe mutual aid, you don't have to start another ambulance. If you can see on your phone that you got people respond, so that's one of them. You can do messaging with it, I could send a message out to all my firefighters, there's a special meeting tonight, there's a training, you can do road closures on it. Robert Rogers closed for an accident for a couple hours, whatever, or construction. You can put mapping on it. The biggest thing is mapping, because all the other compact towns are in it. So if you go mutual aid, you can look at your phone and see the map, you can see exactly where you're going. You can do water sources, we could put every Dunbarton water source on it.
Yep.
So somebody could look on their phone and say, here are the water sources in Dunbarton. You can do pre-plans of buildings. There's a lot you can do to this system. So, you know, we think it's worth it. So. That would be an $800 yearly feeable to have the program. And they give you upgrades. They do a lot of tech stuff for you,
yep.
The company. So anyways, we've discussed it at meetings and the compacts discussed it, and we think it's a pretty good program to go with. But to back up to the mobile phone, I can't do it on my current phone. Won't allow them, there'd be no benefit for me if I had to upgrade to a smartphone. So, you know, similarly,
to the 21st
kind of a basic
job.
Phone, something like Woody's yeah. Doing for the transfer. It's basically the same phone. So that's why that's an increase of $3,000. Plus, I got to keep $1,000 in for the.
The mobile phone that you need for it would be come out of the mobile home line,
yep.
Right?
But that line has been used more because the money got spent taken out of that line for the internet.
This is updated.
There is? I don't have that updated.
Well, the internet for the Wi-Fi or internet out of the, as in the station itself?
Station.
That should just come out of the regular standard telephone line, I would think. So, I mean,
well,
it's
I've been
DSL.
Taken out of this line. I've been taken out of the...
I mean, it's just straight DSL right out of the phone line, so I mean, it's all kind of part of the phone.
Yeah. But I think it would put me over on my budget if I did it that way. But this, because we didn't have that until that, until we did
well,
the renovations.
You can overspend a line.
Yeah.
And
oh, yeah.
Spend a line. So
yeah.
Yeah.
But this line, well, it doesn't matter actually on the bottom line where it's going to come out of. I mean,
right.
We can budget that and adjust it around
right.
To make it show where it's actually coming out of. But
mm-hmm.
I was taking out of this. Fee and service line, because that fee was what I was paying for
mm-hmm.
when I was paying the $750 for the firehouse program.
Gotcha.
So I stopped.
So you can cut back up now. You said the computer got a virus and all that stuff. And I know we talked
this
about
this is
that.
A separate, not the town computer that we got now. This was our, we had our own computers
right.
Over there, system over there, and it's an old program. You know, it was
right. Well, I know
the operating system
talking about get you a town computer,
right.
So I assume you're going to put all the new software on
exactly.
The town computer, right?
Right. That's why we were going to approach Firehouse to try to get it. We'd have to put it into our computer. Because all the program we have now is outdated. I mean, it works. It suffices. The state
right.
Takes it.
Mm-hmm.
But for us to get it onto a new computer,
mm-hmm.
We'd have to go through them
I
to
understand.
Get it done. So that's why we're kind of stuck.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Jim gotten in touch with you yet?
They
gave me a number.
So
yeah, because I mean, you look to
have
to make sure your
yeah.
Computers get the protection
exactly.
That
yeah.
It needs
yeah.
In the
we
back.
Put,
and all
put,
that.
Because the operating system the old one had, we couldn't put enough virus protection. That's how it got the.
Was that old, huh?
Yeah. That's how it got the. but we were only using it for basically the firehouse reporting program. So, and it was a hand me down from here originally, so.
There's a lot of hand-me-downs.
Yeah, we don't
yeah.
Need a lot of new stuff a lot
yeah.
Of times, but
you still got off a phone.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
Phone.
This is.
I mean, I had one too until one broke, but then I had to go to
the.
Cheap
old cruises.
This has kind of put us into something we had to do, so. But anyways, bottom line is, it'd be a $3,342 increase. Still under 90,000, so it's pretty good deal early, fire most of fire service.
Yep.
Paid the what our neighbors budgets are.
Absolutely. No, I think it's, I mean, you gotta be able to do your job, and you got, you know, requirements by the state and stuff, that's, I mean, you gotta have your software.
Gotta have this, computer programs and software and the phones, I mean, you know, running the ambulance service is expensive venture, really, I mean.
Speaking of, how's that going with getting the billing and all that going? I know last year was kind of getting over.
Yeah, we switched over to the new billing service and.
Things going good?
Yeah, they electronically switched, yeah, Lean, yeah, she,
One of my many heads.
She gets involved in it, yeah, 'cause we still recently received checks here, and that has to be, you know, we have to scan that to them, you know, even though we deposit them, then they send us, you know, monthly bank statements and updates and money they receive, and, you know, I've had a couple insurance companies request, you know, car accidents, and I get insurance requests all the time for stuff, and, you know, I've been there just to pass it on to them. You know, they give them the reports and handle the whole thing, so that's, you know, one less thing I have to do.
Yep.
But our other billing company wasn't, they would, I still have to provide that information for them.
Gotcha.
So, yeah, it's working out all right, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
Pretty limited of what we can use out there for services, so this company, yeah, they're Massachusetts, and seem to be okay. Yep. That paramedic intercept line, that's another, you know, we've averaged for the last few years, but, so I just put that in there, but you can see, obviously, this year, we've only, actually, I got another one I gotta submit, but luckily, you know, we do have a paramedic in town, who's, comes up a lot of calls this year that we would've called a paramedic for, that he happened to be around, he works full-time as a firefighter. He just switched, he wasn't Hawking, he's moved the boat fire, but, you know, he just bought the house, and he's been living that long, he just bought a house, so, you know, he tends to be around for a while, so. He happened to be around, on some of those calls that we needed a paramedic for, a car accident we had this summer, and some other calls. This cardiac arrest we had yesterday, you know, we had a call for an intercept, but he was actually the one came from Bo, but,
That's good.
Because he wasn't transported, they pronounced him at the house, he wasn't transported, so there won't be a fee for that, so, but it would've been, because, you know, we called Bo for an intercept, so.
Right.
That figure, just, you never know, we might have 10 serious calls this year, and we need paramedic, and he was around, but this year just happened to fall that he was around when we needed a medic.
Well, that's a good honor.
And then there's, you know, if they, we've had somebody come, if they transport, actually make it to the scene, and we put the patient in their truck, there's no charge, 'cause they get the whole bill. It's when we're en route to the hospital, and they, you know, intercept us, meet us en route, and their medic gets in with us, then that's the charge.
That's
all. Sometimes, you know, Bo's close enough and Conkey comes out, that they actually get to the scene before, you know, we start en route, so there's no fee. So that happens, you know, three or four times this year too, so there's no charge, so that fee, you know, it's just, you have to budget a fee, and forcing the work for it, maybe we can reduce it. Anyways, that's the bottom line.
I know it's pretty good, I know what you're saying.
Yeah, me too, it's straightforward.
I mean, the only thing, I understand where you're coming from, you know, like, to come back on that point system thing.
Yep.
But to have such a revolving, you know, never having an actual physical established dollar amount for these guys, it's a, you know, it's kind of crapshoot.
Yeah.
I mean.
At some point, we talk about.
Me personally, I think to be fair to them, they should have something established, and if it goes up every year, so be it, we, you know, I mean, 'cause they do such a good job for us, I mean, I really don't like seeing, you know, like this year is $6 and change, next year it could be $5 and change, to me, that's not fair to them. So, maybe we can do something, I don't know, but I'm just, that's just my gut feeling, because.
Yes, I mean, as town grows and we get more calls, we're gonna actually have to go to an hourly fee, I mean, that's the next step.
Yep. But I mean, in the meantime.
Federal law allows us to pay a stipend and still be considered a volunteer fire department, which, you know, has some benefits.
Yep.
But, yeah, and I mean, people understand, I mean, the more you come, the more you're gonna get, what you're gonna earn, and, some people don't do it for the money.
Oh, absolutely. But I mean, we don't lose volunteers either.
Yeah, and, you know, it's not a lot of money, but, you know, it helps cover, like I said, you.
Well, we do it for the police department.
What's that?
Stipend.
Yes.
Yeah, Chris from Millard, and I think this year Dan's proposing a stipend for, Lynn.
For.
Or blank.
For.
Laura, yeah.
Yeah, so.
I mean, that could be, you know, a couple hundred bucks or something, I mean, you know, to.
I mean, it's something that we, I mean, we're still gonna, you know, this point area, so, but I mean, just, you know, that's just my gut feeling, cause I.
Well, we worked, we, you know, we worked for this thing for 10 years, and, you know, it has worked, so like I said, we've had a couple guys that we, they won't take it. It's like, they just wanna donate all their time, and,
I mean, thank you very much, I mean, that, but that's their choice, but I mean, there's people that don't.
Yeah, that's their choice, but. Yeah, and, you know, it covers your fuel, gas, you get ruined clothes and calls, and,
Interrupt your own, yeah.
It's a little incentive, it's, like I said, it's not a lot of money, but, you know, we weren't getting people out for training back, you know, 10 years ago, and some people come to training, and, actually, you know, I pay an extra point if a person goes en route to, goes to the hospital, because that's an extra hour anyways, and it was getting to the point where some people would go to the call, but they didn't wanna go to the hospital, well, there's another whole side of the ambulance business going to the hospital, you gotta know that side of it too, you need to.
Yep.
Know what you do when you get to the hospital, there's paperwork, so, that's helped out, you know, it just gives somebody a little extra, cause if you go to the call and come home, you might have only been there 45 minutes, half an hour, the poor guy goes to the LA hospital, he's gone for 2.5 hours.
Yep.
So, you know, if you give it a little bit of incentive, I give them an extra point if they go and they transport, because if you waste more time, it's just a time thing, but, and some people don't look at it that way, but some people. But, you know, it has helped.
Again, that's just my gut feeling right now, in this preliminary discussion, but, I don't know what you, you know, you don't think, but, you know, we can discuss that as we craft a budget, but.
Exactly.
Well, I say I learned something every time we look at this.
Yeah.
Cause I didn't realize it was a.
Yeah, well, you know, we looked at the different programs 10 years ago, you know, talked about chief house, you know, most people just pay an hourly rate.
How about the Warner?
It would be, well, we're going for a grant for our air packs, but because that was the same, basically the same language, I think we don't have to do anything, right?
I think this time we wrote it up as a non-lapsing, right?
Right, it's non-lapsing.
Yeah.
Yeah, just double check that, make sure.
We did get it, and, we'd like to put some more money away for the engine,
Yeah.
We did last year. Tweaked that a little bit, and then, how about staff car, the command vehicle, that's not gonna pass inspection again, so it's good until, but I don't know what the police chief has proposed for a vehicle. I mean, him and I have talked about, he wants to get another vehicle.
He's proposing getting another vehicle and turning the, was it Tahoe too?
Tahoe.
Yeah.
So if that worked, that'd be great, but if town meeting gets shut down, then I might have to put an article to get some money for a used car. You don't need a new vehicle, but if you can get on the police rotation, that's the best way to do it. I mean, most towns that our size just take hand-me-downs from the police department. You know, they're late model cars, they have some mileage on them, but most of them are okay. We would have been in that rotation here, but they blew a motor in that 07 and that put the whole kink into the operation. Middle town, Chichester, they just got an SUV from that police department. They all fixed a nice one. Pounds, Salisbury, they all got hand-me-down police cars. Like I said, they're late model, but, you know, some high mileage, but for five-timer use, they work great.
Yep.
You know, pretty high for me going just by buying a $50,000, $60,000 SUV.
Right.
But, you know, we need a vehicle for operations, I mean, for command and with, we all listen what we do with the car, but, you know, we paid, the first one I paid $3,500 for, and we knew at the time it was a throwaway car, 2 years, the dealer said, you know, the car probably got you 2 years, and mechanic goes, they better rust it out, and Ford has a, seems to have a rust problem, so we'll explore. And then this one, same thing, this is a, the guy told us when we bought this, we paid, I think, four for this, he said, you might get two, 3 years out of it, which is what we're gonna get, but same thing, it's, the rust has got to that car, and when I got inspected in September, they said, you know, no way it ever pass again next September. And, you know, you don't want to dump money into the thing, you know, that stuff, you can't repair, you know, the strut towers and stuff, it's got some rust on it. So, if the police deal applies, that'd be great, if it doesn't, I might have to have a backup plan to.
Yeah, two warrant articles, one for a police cruiser, and then if it provide Allen passes, then, you know, warrant article would take into.
Right.
Move on to the next one.
So you have to come up with some numbers for me?
Yeah.
And the engine warrant, do we even do 20?
No, it's not that.
It's like 40 or 60.
Forty last year?
I don't know, look at it.
I'll look at it.
I think it was 40.
Yeah, I'll look at it, and then, I think we're all set on that grant. No numbers have changed, no dollar numbers have changed, it's the same grant, we just.
Rewrote it?
Yeah.
Might be if you have to check, Tammy wrote it as well, but it's basically the same language, it would be the same thing, money just coming out of the ambulance account.
Okay.
Balance fee, the, you know, it's under a couple thousand dollars.
And that's where all the insurance payments go, that you get just in the ambulance.
Right, but it's not, it's just for ambulance, it's, the way it's worded is for.
Equipment too, right, but I mean, that's where it's, the money's going.
Yeah, and that, might, we'll have to check for the insurance company, we can, we lost that, that red 57.
Yeah.
And.
Then I have to go back.
I put a claim in with our insurance company, and they denied it because they weren't the insurance company when we lost it.
When we lost what now?
I have to go.
Piece of equipment, do we have it checks your carbon monoxide level in your blood stream? And, it's called the red 57, we got it on our grant quite a few years ago, and it disappeared somehow. We've investigated, we had the police, you know, filed the police report, it might have been stolen. Backtracked every call that we had, checked with every hospital, we know the last time we had it. Pretty sure we did, and then the calls we had in between, we went to their houses. Thing had just vanished.
Gotcha.
And it's a $5,000 piece of equipment, so.
Sure.
Yeah, so after we looked for, granted, we didn't report it to them right off the bat because we hoping it would show up. So we spent some time looking for it. Like I said, I did file a police report for them, so finally, you know, months ago, I said, it doesn't look like it's gonna appear. So we'll file an insurance claim. So I filed an insurance claim, and because the company we have now wasn't the insurance company when we lost it, so they denied it. So they said you need to go back to the other company.
PLT.
Because.
And they have handed all their remaining funds to a third party, so that's, I have to send.
Oh, it's gonna be a quagmire.
Some more money, yep.
It's gonna be a quagmire.
Yeah.
So if it doesn't work out, you might have to ask to take money out of the ambulance fund to buy another.
Okay, so that could be another one.
Yep.
I'll work on that next week.
Like I said, when we originally got it, they were like $3,500. And we got it through a grant from the Hampshire Professional Firefighters Association. And then, so, and actually that was another thing the guy, my father claimed, is how come you claim now it's worth, it's $5,000 of change, and you said it was worth $3,500 when it was stolen. That's what it was worth, you know, back then. Now it's gone up. They've gone up to $5,000 for some reason. So, that was one of his other issues he had, but. So anyways, we might have to ask to take the money out of that account, and that's just a, you know, kind of a formality, yes.
Well, what was it called again?
Red 57.
So red 57, it's a carbon monoxide detector that you check your carbon monoxide. The advantage of it, today with so many carbon monoxide issues you run into, if you don't have one of these machines, you have to do a blood test. So you have to transport somebody to the hospital and actually do a blood test, or use their house and they did have elevated carbon monoxide level, and the person said, oh, I'm not feeling too good, put this on their finger and you can tell what their CO level is in the bloodstream, so it's a pretty good machine.
Yeah.
Have.
Do you have any right now, or you have none?
Yeah, and we're in the middle of winter season.
Yeah, so that's why this fall, I said, well, maybe I'll just, you know, it didn't show up all summer, I said, well, do insurance claim and try to get one through the insurance company. And like I said, they denied it right off the bat, so. But, so that could be a potential, you know, ask the people to take the money out of the account and buy that.
Well, we can prepare the warrant article, just be ready, just in case, if the insurance company works out, great, but if it doesn't, we're be ready to go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we don't have to take and rush and get it done.
Yeah. And the emergency management, and that's $1,000 that we carry every year, and just kind of in the contingency fund. Yeah, if we had to buy food, we had to open the shelter. I mean, that's basically what it's there for, and then, you know, it comes towards the end of the year, like, you know, you pay for the generator repairs or, you know, buy a piece of equipment or something, but normally we just roll that over.
Buy a lot of bottled water when everybody runs out of water.
Huh?
Buy water, bottle of water when everybody runs out of water.
Yeah.
So, yeah, how do we do it?
We did get a lot, actually, during the ice storm, through the state. I mean, we were, they provided towns with cases and cases of water, and we did get some, quite a few carts that are stored over for the school. It'd take you quite a while there to dig them out, but two bathrooms, the showers over there, they don't use the storage.
Yeah, I know.
There's an inspection over there, so that's one of the issues I got. Ding them on. They got to do something else. They use every single inch of that building for storage and stuff, and some of the house practices over there. But those two shower rooms, though. And the other issue, there was a, they had an odor over there. You know, leaks are going.
It's not the floor drains again.
Oh, yeah, it's the showers, the traps in the showers.
Oh, they dry out.
Dry out.
Yeah.
And they get sewer gas.
Yep.
Oh, we're told. Well,
to get to those showers is a
project. I think it was a Gens, was the principal, or was it Starvish? Rogers, I know, told them that happened, you know, just they put some water down and like that,
yeah,
all the drain again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, keep it, and then take some vegetable oil and put,
right.
it, and put it on there so that it doesn't
evaporate.
End of story, you know, it'll stay right there. Because, I mean.
There's a vegetable, sorry. Fire.
Yeah. So that way you keep the vegetable oil on it, you know, it's not, it's biodegradable
type
thing, it's not poisonous,
not
like motor oil. And it just seals the water so that it doesn't take and evaporate and you never have the problem again.
Yeah.
I mean, that was, but I mean, that's like three or four principles ago, so it's probably been long forgotten over there.
Yeah, and we did use them during the ice storm, between two out, used to. So they were, I used them, the other two.
Do you want to bring them up to speed on the lack of water in the fire department and town buildings? Monday night.
Yeah, we went to the fire station Monday night, went to use the garden holes and didn't get anything out of it. So, well, maybe it's frozen because during the construction they rerouted it, but you know, it's been pretty cold there over the weekend. So
you saw at the fire station?
Yeah. Yeah. But you saw packs, so somebody ran upstairs and there's no water in the building. Like, oh, it's not too good, so.
Fire department only, or?
Every time, Bill.
We came over here,
so we
no water.
Bob was here, happy to be here, because I called Lane, and she took a few minutes to get back to us. so I go,
I'm trying to turn my phone off.
I'm not trying to throw you into the bus, but, you know, she's at home, she didn't have to answer her texts. It's not her job. So
it
anyway,
just was 7, it was what, 7:10 when you called?
And I said, well, obviously there's a water issue, so we went over to, but, J.I. was at the fire station, took him over, and there was no power to the switch. There was no pressure on any of the gauges at the, you know, it all comes from the town hall. And there's no zero pressure in the gauges, and there was nothing to the switch. The switch was power. He didn't have a tester with him, but, you know, he's trying to jump it, see if it fires, so it was obviously an issue. So we came over here, and there's no water. You know, they had a meeting here, Bob was here. So the Bob, what do you want to do? Go and get a hold of somebody, so. And, in the meantime, by the time we got back to the station, I was gonna go back and get JR, Lean texted me back, or called me, actually called me, and said, you know, what's up? Cause I told him, call me. Said, there's no water in the town buildings, so, she says, well, why are you JR? So, okay, but he had some service calls and had something else to do, so he never got till at the midnight. Well, he told me he'd get to it early in the morning before anybody came in. Oh yeah, then I saw the police, and I said, you know, there's no water in the building. Oh yeah, figured that out a little while ago, I go, don't flush the toilet, cause.
Let your neighbor know.
So anyways, so he actually came in at midnight and repaired it. The pressure switch, pump switch is bad.
Yeah.
So he got that going, but he's over there, it's building rapid pressure when the water's coming on. So he says it's common for those tanks, they get corroded, the bottom of the tank. And there's just a small hole in there and the water, the pressure builds up quick. Cause, you know, it's not, you're not getting the water flow.
Right, you're not getting the volume, you're just getting the pressure.
So they're building up quick, so he's, I don't know what he's told Lean about.
Yeah, there's four tanks down there, and he said exactly what John said to me, he checked in about 10 after 6. And he said that the tanks that are in there are original from when they installed them when he was a kid, and it was supplying water to the community homes here. So he said the problem is you can either replace the switch, but when that is, when it's triggering the switch to pop, that means there's something wrong with the tank. And if they ignore it for too long and try to invest in just a part of it, it'll eventually reroute to the pump.
Pump itself.
The well, the pump, well pump.
Yeah.
So he's gonna get some prices on tanks and whatever else he needs to.
I'm not sure how many tanks is that either.
There's four down there, I don't know if they've all failed or.
Yeah, they might go to a bigger size.
He said we could probably go to a smaller size.
Oh, small?
Yeah.
Yeah, we don't.
Because it's only the three buildings, whereas before it was all the community area.
Yeah, cause there's piping, there's a pipe at nightmare. If you look at all the pipes, we're trying to trace them there at night, thinking maybe somebody was down and shut a valve off for some reason. But, you know, they're all marked back when it goes to so-and-so's house, this goes somewhere, you know, there's names written on all the pipes.
I still don't get how it goes from the well over here and it's going all the way over to the fire department.
Isn't that crazy? Yeah.
Yeah, so.
And the town, and the school has its own well.
School's on it.
So why wouldn't the fire department at least be on that well?
It's closer.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
You know what, probably plumbing already existed.
Yeah. Pipes already,
So we might, you know, have to budget that for.
So they must have gone out, cause Lean said she was here.
I was washing my dishes just before 7 and I left it like.
So you're the one that.
Yes.
Your fault.
No, I left.
We get there at 10 past and there's no water, which is strange. And like I said, Bob was over here, we came over here. Obviously there's no water here either, so. But luckily got it resolved before.
Yeah.
And people came to work in the morning, found out there was any water. He went, he initially planned to come in early, but he ended up deciding to do it at midnight.
Yeah, probably went to bed and he wouldn't be getting up early.
At least it wasn't too big.
That's what he was concerned with that night, that it'd be the pump with that.
Oh, that'd be brutal.
Yeah.
Ended up.
Okay, for John.
Oh.
You both?
Thank you, John.
Thank you, John, appreciate it.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Okey dokey then, how was it for town business, what's in the pocket here? Alrighty.
Mailbox?
This is the mailbox. You wanna do your copier?
I'm gonna try, I'm really tired and I'm extremely busy this week.
Alright, jump, put the jump forward, who wants it?
Alright, so, last week I brought before the board a spreadsheet.
I brought it back with me.
With a request for a new copier, scanner, printer for the town clerk's office. And we came in with a workhorse center that we could also include under our other office copier. service. They were able to give us, include the $1,986 copier with a no charge for the service, zero base, and then that would allow us 6,000 copies, a year, and then if you went over, we're looking at like $60 a year for overage, which I thought was reasonable. And then I was also considering asking the board to replace this model here, because it regularly, minimum once a month, usually more like twice a month, we call for service here. It's covered 100%, we don't ever have any problems. They're here either the same day or the next day for service, covers, everything, parts, labor, travel, except for paper, toner, it's included, everything. So I was considering this, and then possibly including Linda's under that service contract, because I have one in my office, which seems to meet our needs. Then board made a recommendation that maybe we shift things around and look at Linda's office to possibly move one of these machines. Tom just happened to stop in last Friday, so we did that, we walked around the building. Mine is definitely the smaller machine. This one would definitely be too big for her office, there's just no way we could fit it in there. There's a lot of low slants in her office right now, even though we reinforced it. The middle room between the tax collector and her office, I'm seeing some real dips in her floor, and there's no way that
yeah,
we
that floor
fit.
Is not a flat.
No, it's not
by
at
no
all.
Means.
So, we also looked at possibly shifting her whole desk, getting a smaller station desk for the deputy, to still have the path that goes around and then be able to fit something there.
Yeah, there's a table in there that's as big as this.
Yeah.
And if that were a shorter table, well, there's a wooden table in there too that
yeah.
maybe could be moved. So I think with a little bit of furniture rearranging and downsizing, mm-hmm. you could put maybe Lean's machine in there.
Right.
Without, you know, without killing yourself too hard.
Right, but that still leaves a copier down. I can't take a copier out of my office.
No, right.
And so then I decided I was going to revisit, or you guys asked me to look into another option for Linda's office. And when I talked to Conica, is that the one?
Conway.
I said that the price that we had quoted for that use that the board felt was a little bit too high. So he gave an option of, and what I'm focusing on is a workhorse, one that's going to last more than 4 years. The original one that we paid, and I have here, $550. We've bought numerous toners that isn't covered under the service. You own it. We had one repair on it. We spent over $1,100 since 2012. So for 4 years, we're spending $1,100. What he did was, I asked him to look at a model that was less. It's similar in features, but maybe a step down in the $1,000 range if you could come in under that. So the way he explained it to me, he says he highly recommends this type of machine. What he could offer us is a, what is it called?
A work center, a 3635X.
But it's a pre-owned?
Pre-owned.
It's not a refurbished. It's a pre-owned machine. Right now, currently has 29,000 copies on it. And it's a $1,600 machine. And you can let it go for $1,000. And then it would be covered under the service contract, similar to what he had.
So as things break down over the course of time.
There's nothing to worry about. Service, travel, toner. The only thing we provide is the paper. And it would be covered under a similar.
Is that a color machine or
black and white?
Black and white.
I don't want, she doesn't need all the extra bells and whistles.
Okay.
So the overage would be at a minimum. As you can see in her, what she's working with, we need a copier in her office.
Right, no, we don't doubt that.
Yeah.
Now, I know she had a concern about having a color copy because she highlights something in yellow. And I know on my renewal notice that I had, I saw
yeah.
that there's
yeah.
a yellow line on there.
That's when she chooses this as an option.
Yeah,
to print
but you know what? Why does it have to be color? Why can't it just be bolded in the larger print? Or does it have to be, I mean, is gray shade considered color? When do they consider it color? You know, if you put it in the shade of gray.
No, gray is black and white. If I printed with gray shades, it would
so,
be black and white.
So why not use a gray shade? Why does it need to be yellow? Because when I looked at my renewal notice, I saw the yellow line there, and there's a lot of other information on there that is bolded.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, why couldn't that just, I mean, it's toward the bottom of the form.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't even remember what it said now, but I did read it.
Yeah.
And, you know, I got thinking about it, and I said, you know, it's a long line of yellow, but does it need to be yellow? Could it be a shade of gray or just, you know, larger lettering and bold it?
Maybe something we can ask her, but.
Yeah.
Not from the way she's going on vacation next week.
Yeah, I know, no, I know. Or even, you know, I mean, there's lots of other ways to highlight things, you know, because I do it all day long too, but.
Yeah.
And I don't use color unless I have to, but.
So, all that being said, if I understand it correctly, you're asking about getting this machine for Liz's area.
Yep.
And doing what else now, on top of that?
In 2017's budget, replace this one.
And replace that one.
Will they take that one and trade, or what do they do with it? Or should we eBay it?
What he said he would recommend doing is, under our service contract, they will make sure it's up and running the best that it can. And then we would run, not continue the service contract on this one and run it into the ground.
Oh, run it until it breaks and then don't until it fixes?
Yeah.
And then what do we do with it? Surplus it?
Well, according to that, when we get a new one, they'll take the old one away if we don't, you know.
But do they give you anything for it?
Yeah, I mean, it's still worth something, isn't it?
We could sell it.
But they don't want it. They would rather you just didn't give it to them.
They'd rather you give it to them for free, you know, they'll take it away.
Yeah, no, they'll take it away, but I'm just saying, they really don't want it.
I mean, you can send it to the white farm and surplus it, I mean.
Yeah.
If they get $50 for it, it's better than getting nothing.
My only concern is I've heard that when you have a copier that scans, the scan stays as an image in the copier. And that if somebody wanted to extract that, it's like the hard drive of a computer.
Is it on memory or is it on a drive?
I think I saw a special too on TV about that, that people don't realize that what is getting scanned has.
Oh, maybe there's a way to blank it out.
Yeah, I'd have to ask Jim.
Yeah.
Scan a bunch of white
blanks. Yeah, well, you don't know how much it retains, that's the problem.
Yeah.
You know, retained every copy you ever made?
I don't think so.
Yeah, me either, but you don't know.
I don't know. Well, the copy people should know that answer for one.
Yeah.
Jim might be able to.
Jim might be.
Yeah, because maybe there's a hard drive, I don't know. If the region is taken out of.
Any thoughts on that?
Well, I have a question.
Yeah.
And I was just waiting. I know it's a pre-owned machine.
Uh-huh.
Can we find out why the person turned that in to get a different machine?
Yeah.
Now, I just want to make sure that somebody didn't turn in a potential problem.
Well, the way he explained it to me is that he would only research a pre-owned and consider it if it was something that he would buy personally. So if it was something that he knew he got, like someone said, take it away, I'm buying a new one.
Sure.
And that's what it says on there, that they will remove old at no cost. They can deliver it, set it up, train.
So is this one of their machines originally, or is this someone else? Yeah.
I don't know.
See, my concern is,
who owned it?
Why is it being spun around?
You know, did they get, upgrade, or?
Okay.
Or maybe it was too big for them.
Well, do we know what your manufacturer is on that?
Could be anything, but, you know.
Or if it'd be a lemon.
Well, I think we should ask the year of manufacture, and if it's a machine that they owned, you know, that was sold by them originally, or is it something that.
Current meter on 29,759.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's really not a lot.
No. No, but how did they come by that machine? Is it something that they sold, or?
Yeah.
Did the guy pick it up?
It could have been in an office, a display room, or, you know.
Yeah, who knows? Yeah, we need to know more about the history of the blah.
Okay, we'll try one more time.
I'm not trying to discourage you, but I mean, if we're gonna invest, you know, and I know it's $1,000, but if you buy a problem, and even though they service it and everything, and they say, well, we didn't know this was wrong with it, we got a problem here, they just don't want us to inherit anything.
The only good thing is it'd be on a service contract that they're on the hook for.
Yeah.
What kind of warranty do you get with something like that, not a refurbished, but a pre-owned?
I think it's on the second page.
You know, do you get 100,000 miles on it, or?
I think they.
You know, kind of get it certified? We make it smaller print too.
This is just terms and conditions.
Okay.
Warranty.
Okay. So I'll check a warranty.
they're a printer company, tell them to go with large, bold, 12 font.
At least, huh?
Jesus, please, Arial, yeah.
All right, I'll check one more time, it won't be tomorrow, because I'm taking tomorrow off.
No.
I know, I'm not taking Tuesday off, too.
Did we sign this?
You working Monday?
I've had so much flex time.
Are you working, is Monday on?
Monday's closed, we're closed, we're not open.
I'm waiting for this to go.
No, I'm just gonna, if I fall over here.
Did we get a, I didn't even see it.
No, it just came in.
Just came in today.
Oh.
I've been so busy with the office.
So we'll table it until next week?
Table it till next week.
Yes.
Now, was that considered in the mailbox or other town business?
It was in the.
It was in the mailbox.
Yeah.
All town purposes.
All town business. It's just where it's coming out of.
It's kinda like which pocket.
Yeah.
The money comes out of.
Yeah. It's all the same pocket.
Alright. Okey dokey, Central New Hampshire Regional Planning Commission is announcing the start of the biannual update of the Regional Transportation Improvement Program. If you really wanna read this whole thing, basically they just say, looking for information if we have anything to add to the potential update of the 10-year plan, the DOT. I don't think we have any projects.
The bridge on Ray.
Did I scan that to you yet? Because I know I scanned it and I meant to forward it to you, because it's like five pages.
Yeah, you got my chance to get it in.
Right.
We're gonna put the circumference of highway around it.
Yeah, I don't think we have any projects.
Because when I was reading that, it says that there's safety concerns or whatever. And if you talk to the people at the end of Ray Road, you know, they're a little nervous.
Bridge.
Yeah.
I understand.
If you go real fast, you can jump the bridge.
You don't have to jump it, you just go around the barriers.
Yeah.
It's still there. Alrighty. So I mean.
Can you pass that down, you just switch it, put the title and everything down?
So I don't know if you gentlemen have any thoughts on potential projects or anything, but I don't think we really have anything in our neck of the woods. It's 1377. And a lot of your roads got
resurfaced. It's all been redone.
Yeah, Ranch Road.
About the Boardway?
Boardway's not a state road.
Oh, state roads, yeah, I wasn't thinking. Mm-hmm. We give it to state.
Yeah, they don't want it, trust me.
Look at the Chelsea.
They try to get rid of them. So. Alrighty, 2016 warrant article number 11, update. This is to see if the town will vote and raise RAIS, missing an E. Raise and appropriate the sum of $44,000 to purchase a new police cruiser with equipment installation. Equipment is summarized in the capital improvements plan, a portion of these funds to come from the police special detail revolving fund in the amount of $18,000 balance, $26,000 come from taxes, 7 cent increase. So that was $44,000 that we appropriated.
Yep.
All said and done at the end of it, we came in at $38,855.32.
Yep.
So that means $2,958.59 is going back as surplus. So,
That warrant had a substantial amount of special duty funds. Allocated for that. This year, I think they're only about at 7-8 grand, so they don't have.
It won't be as much.
That much, so if they're moving forward with that warrant this year, so.
So, anyway.
Okay.
Yep.
There you go. And then we also have just a copy of the letter that was sent to Mike Iney and Dave Nault regarding Kelsey Road.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, so they got the official notification.
Yep, they did.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Excellent.
I'm sure he will keep us informed when there's a court date and all that good stuff.
Yep.
So. Alrighty. True North Data. Kato, or whatever it comes with.
Can I just keep, sorry?
It's okay.
Just something.
Jim's gonna talk to us about that next week.
Alright, so you wanna hold on to next week?
Yeah, we'll table that.
Alright.
Yep.
good. That's even the mailbox, so.
I just wanted to, I think I've been in communication with Tom and Bob regarding your request to restore your involuntary merge. He said he was a little bit busy, but he did return an email to me.
He was a little busy.
There was something, and he would have to wait, Steve Whitley.
Oh, Steve.
And he said it might not be till the end of the week or early next week, but he got back to me yesterday, and he's got some more questions, so I'm kind of pulling some more information.
Anything I can answer?
Pardon?
Anything that I can answer?
No, it involves title research, and I have done some research of your lot file and the registry of deeds. I've got Ken looking at the information, and I have a statement I wanna return to him, but I just want Ken's opinion on what I've found before I send that up, and so it's not quite done yet.
You have to go 30 days, right?
Yep.
Anything else? The group?
Just a reminder, planning board is working with Central New Hampshire Regional Planning regarding the master plan update. They are scheduling a visioning session to be held January 25th with a snow date of the 26th. Yes, and I'm supposed to remind you, if you have anything to inform the board, that is coming up.
Well, you might, I'll chime in on a little bit on that.
Yes.
Yeah, the planning board meeting last night. Again, that is Wednesday, January 25th at the elementary school, if all goes well. That's the plan. They're hoping to have pizza there and everything, so we can get some bodies. We're gonna be sending out, advertising it at the school, you know, to the kids, that sort of thing, get the parents there. Also, the group, the planning board has decided to go with postcards to mail out to the residents, hopefully to entice them to come in and give us their 2 cents, and hopefully get it on the marquee and advertise in the local newspapers like the Bow Times or whatever else what we use or have out there. If there's a storm of some sort, they're looking for a rain date of the 26th, which would be a selectman's meeting. So would we be okay with that?
Yeah, why not?
I think they said 6:30, right, start?
Yeah, start at 6:30.
Yeah.
So, I mean, because I would think they'd probably like to have us over there as a group.
They don't have a problem.
Okay. So then we'll, that was their question, and I said I'd bring it to you guys tonight. So, hopefully we won't need it, but if we do, we have it for the next day, so.
Yeah.
I'll let Steve know. Hopefully it's very similar to the situation we did with the university, which we called those folks there, cooperative extension. We've actually given the central planning commission, was it central planning commission?
Yeah, central,
planning commission. Yep. Yeah, I get the name right. We've given them a copy of that as well. That final report, so they have it, so they're looking at it, and they're going to utilize some of that as well for the master plan. So that's about the update of it. We've got the transportation chapter done. They're working on the demographics chapter now. That one's almost finished up, and they're working with the conservation commission right now on theirs, and the next year will be the last half of it. So not quite half done, but almost there, so. That's what's going on with the master plan.
I just have one other item. I received a call from Jim Micho this week. He said he met with Mary Gerard at the library. He'll probably touch on it a little bit more for us next week, but right now he says that they have 2 staff stations and 1 viewing station and a viewing card catalog. To configure all the machines so that they're covered under the town's tech support would be run approximately $1,500 to $2,000. Monthly user fees are $99 per month, so we're looking at $8,400 for annual support for all the machines. And then...
That's just for their machines?
Yeah.
What are we paying?
$99 a month.
Alright.
$99 a month for each, and we just added Woody, so I think we're up to 11 now.
Yeah, alright.
And then Microsoft Outlook user is only $12.50 because of government per month. He would only, he recommends only doing the staff stations, obviously. So we're looking at $150 annual cost for that, so. 48, 68 plus 150, almost $7,000 to get them up and running if they go under this umbrella. I mean, he would extend our cost to them if they're interested in going that route. I can't remember what they budgeted for that, if they had something substantial. Or if it included a computer or something, if they're buying a new computer. Well, you got the impression that if Mary had her way, she'd have a lot of high-tech, really nice, fancy equipment there, so.
Libraries were the first ones we did, right?
Library was a different one, it was
Yeah, they were the first.
Oh, it's in there somewhere. You know what, I'm about 2 seconds from saying, I'll figure it out next week.
Yep.
Can I answer that question? Yeah.
I just have one question for you, but I'll do that after. It's personal, I just wanna talk to you for a minute.
Sure.
After.
Alrighty.
My turn?
Sure.
I have a question. Last week, there when Lee and I were in the Tom Flark's area there, where we're eyeballing where we put the printer. While we were there, we also looked at that big cabinet that's in there, that thing is massive. And I know there's
Fireproof one?
Yeah. And well, there's a bunch of cabinets in there, but the fireproof one's a big cabinet. And I'm sure the thing is pretty hefty. But before we spend any money on additional cabinets, I think the first thing they need to do is an inventory and determine what's in there and what really belongs to the town, what maybe doesn't belong to the town, what's an original, what's a copy. Because, I think it hasn't come to the Selectman and been, given to the town, that it shouldn't be there. If it's a copy, it shouldn't be there. To me, something like that should be originals. If we're spending money on preservation, somebody has the originals, they can just make another copy. But if it's a copy, I don't think spending money around a copy makes, I mean, to me, it doesn't make any sense. Maybe, unless there's some extenuating circumstance around it, but I think before you invest in anything for preservation, we should have an inventory of what we have and who owns it.
Because the fact that you speak of copies, with today's technology, you could eliminate the copy, scan it.
Right.
All these computers scan. And you can scan them into a folder.
Right.
Whatever you scan, then you now title it and name it.
Yeah.
You put it in a subfolder, and then you take that on a flash drive.
And I don't know what those cabinets cost, but even if, to eliminate the cabinet and, all of that, if it makes sense to scan, maybe you hire a third party that does that for you, and it might be less expensive than the cabinet, and then it sits out on the cloud, wherever that is, and, multiple people can have access to it, somehow secure.
Yeah.
I don't know, I think there's other ways, but I think the first thing you need is an inventory, before you go out and spend crazy money, because we know that floor in there won't support additional weight.
I
mean, we were in there looking at it the other day, and that floor is like a roller coaster.
Yeah.
And I have no idea what's underneath it, but, I think.
You probably don't want to
know. No, probably not. Spiders, I'm sure, they got good ones. But, I was just my thought on that.
Okay. Probably not a bad idea. Along with a policy on, where it goes, signing it out and tracking it.
Yeah, because right now it seems like we don't have one. We just keep adding to the pile, I think.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
If someone takes a pile, you don't know if it's missing or not.
Right, exactly, yeah.
So everything you're missing, everything's been, has shown up in the vault, so everything's back to where it was.
Cool, excellent.
Don't know how that happened, but it's there.
It's all good, don't ask any questions, just be thankful.
And I'll just change the combination so it stays in there.
Other than that, I didn't have anything else, I was, bad in the printer thing, we already talked about that.
All right, the only I got for, was the planning board stuff from the master plan. Came in the mail today, just everybody's edification. The school district sent out these nice orange cards, says public forum on Dunbarton School District Capital Improvement Plans, Facilities and Budgeting on the 11th of January at 6:30 at the DES Library. So just to give everybody a heads up that the school is planning on.
They just contacted me today and just put it on Hot Topics.
So, all righty, wasn't sure.
And what it's in for?
Yes, they're taking over the capital improvements plan that they have, one they never want to share with us. And they're, was it budgeting and what else were the facilities?
Capital improvement, budgeting.
They want feedback.
Physical space needs, possible options. Geez, and they're only doing that in the library? Not expending much of a turnout, I guess.
Guess not.
I got one in the mail. I got one today in the mail.
Yeah.
Yeah, I got it just as I got home, so I threw it with a pile here and thought I'd just share with everybody.
Cool.
So, about all I got, that's all I got, right off the top of my head.
Yeah, I'll reiterate what Tom said, I think maybe going through his cabinets. I can understand the one-of-a-kind documents, they're probably important to have a standalone document if there's something there, but I think there's a little bit more there than just what's in the cabinet besides, because there's a cost that goes with a fireproof safe going in that room, takes a little bit of work underneath.
Oh, yeah.
If you're gonna do that,
yeah.
You know.
You're not gonna just put them in the space limited.
I think it takes a little more planning, but that's something we'll discuss when we talk about the budget, because it takes more planning than they think. Just buying something and sticking it in there.
Absolutely.
That's about all I have.
Gotcha. That'll be your last meeting, right?
I'll be here next time.
You're gonna be here? Wasn't sure, just checking.
I'll still be here. Keep it running that easy.
Oh, that's fine.
One more.
I'm not trying to get it here, I'm just asking. All righty then. Public comment, I guess, Liam?
Yeah, same as what they were talking about, I was at the meeting, the historical awareness meeting this week, and Linda brought two boxes of pictures in, and I'd say at least 50% of what I saw didn't even belong to town. And then there were a lot of pictures of just headshots of people, and nobody knew who they were. They could have been somebody from Manchester, Then we had stuff from Francistown, Ware, New Boston, all over. So if you went through all that stuff, we might clean out a lot of crap, I mean, it's nice to show and look at those old things, but they don't belong to us, send them off to where they belong, Make some room.
Mike?
Just want to say thank you for at least bringing it up. I think inventory is step one.
I think that's important, because otherwise you don't have a clue what you have. And if somebody's doing a project, research, whatever, right now it's, we don't know.
Thank you for at least, I think that's step one, so kudos to the board.
Won't happen until after the holiday though, I'm sure. Woody? All right, if I hear anything else, then close public comments, and we don't need to go in non-public, do we? Yeah, so what you need to talk to, ask?
I just want to ask you something.
Just me?
Yeah, I want to ask if you're available.
Oh, so I'm on the hot seat, okay.
Yeah.
I thought you meant these guys too. That's okay, so I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion to go home.
Second.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Have a good holiday.
Merry Christmas, everybody. Happy Hanukkah and Kwanzaa.